Great morning, my dear friends. Bhupesh Anand this side. By profession, I'm a chartered accountant, I'm a company secretary, and I'm a cost accountant. And I did diploma in international financial reporting standards from ACCA London. And today, I will be delivering a lecture on discounted cash flow applications, a reading of quantitative methods. And we are today in the lecture number 3. And this lecture is totally focused on internal rate of return. No doubt in lecture number 2, we have discussed what is the meaning of internal rate of return. But in this lecture, that is in lecture number 3, I will be telling you that what are the implications or what are the interpretations of internal rate of return. And what are the limitations of internal rate of return? So I will be dealing with two aspects. One is interpretation of internal rate of return, and second is the limitations of internal rate of return. So my dear friend, let me tell you, this lecture is very important and highly testable in the examination, because if you understand this, then only we can, you know, go in lecture number 4, that what is a decision rule, that when or how you will decide that whether you decide on the basis of NPV or whether you decide on the basis of IRR. So that why there is a conflict between the decisions in case of mutually exclusive projects or in case of independent proposals. So lecture number 4 is dependent on this lecture, and lecture number 3 is dependent on lecture number 2. Hope you have already seen lecture number 2. In that, I have told you that we can calculate NPV, net present value, and IRR. Now, IRR can be calculated. You know, when I say IRR, it is internal rate of return. So please take out your registers. Let me start doing with explanation. Lecture 3, discounted cash flow. And today, that is in lecture number 3 and lecture number 4, I will be dealing with learning outcome number B. That is, what is or compare the NPV rule with IRR rule and find out the best in that. Now, before comparing with NPV and IRR, let me tell you, I firstly should be aware of that. What is the real meaning of IRR? What are the interpretations of IRR? And what are the limitations of IRR? Then only it is better to compare NPV with IRR. So let me start with the journey. I want to tell you what are the interpretations of internal rate of return. Now, when I say internal rate of return, as the name indicates, internal, what you are feeling internally. It means if you are investing in a project, how much inflow, how much return you are getting from that project. That is named as internal rate of return. It is not to be compared, you know, in this internal rate of return, we will not subtract any cost of financing, only the pure meaning, the pure return which I am getting without paying any cost of financing from that project. Because if I deduct cost of financing, then that is not rate of return. That is not internal rate of return. That will be some other rate of return. I want to find out what is that rate of return at which present value of cash inflows is equal to present value of outflows. It means the highest discounting rate. What should be the highest discounting rate so that that NPV of that project comes to zero? So I want to find out that internal rate, that is named as internal rate of return, at which if I put that I in the cash flow function, my NPV is coming as zero. That is named as IRR, and it is pure return from a project. So please write interpretations of IRR in your register. Very important for your examination. Interpretation number 1, this interpretation is standard and mathematical in nature. First two interpretations, there are 3 interpretations in total. First two interpretations are mathematical and statistical in nature. When I say mathematics, I mean the rate at which NPV is zero. Or when I say statistics, I mean the rate at which present value of cash inflows is equal to present value of cash outflows, and I am not aware of that rate. So it can be either calculated with the help of a trial and error method or with the help of financial calculator. So please, I will be telling you both, that how I can calculate IRR with the help of a trial and error. If I am not using that cash flow function, you know, with the help of cash flow, I can directly calculate IRR. But if I am not using that cash flow function, then how I can calculate IRR? And and with how, with the help of trial and error, I can calculate. So my dear friends, please write down interpretation number one. This interpretation is standard and mathematical and statistical in nature. As per this interpretation, IRR is the rate of return at which NPV becomes zero. It is the rate of return at which NPV becomes zero. We are aware of, we have discussed in lecture number two also, interpretation number two, as NPV is equal to zero. So IRR is the rate. So IRR, it is, when I say something is zero and I know that NPV is equal to present value of cash inflows minus present value of cash outflows. When I say NPV is zero, it means it can only be zero if present value of cash inflows, the inflows which I am getting from that project, is exactly equal to the outflows which I am getting from that project. If both are equal, then only I can say it is an interpretation of IRR. So I have discussed two interpretations. The first interpretation is, it is that rate when NPV becomes zero. And second interpretation depends upon first. When I say that it is the rate when NPV is zero, then I can also say that present value of cash inflows, it is that rate where present value of cash inflows is equal to present value of cash outflows. And the third interpretation, I have given 3-star, very important interpretation. So firstly, write down, then I will be explaining with that. IRR is the rate, pure rate earned on a project. This is the most important, as name indicates, internal, what you are feeling internally without any external environment, without the effect of external environment, what you are feeling internally, that is more important. So that rate of return which we are getting from that project, without subtracting any external cost, dividend cost, interest cost, I'm not concerned with that. I'm only concerned with my internal environment. That is named as internal rate of return. So internal rate of return is that rate on a project, is the rate earned on a project. So please underline, earned, pure rate which I earn on a project. Now, in order to understand these three interpretations, that it is the rate at which NPV is equal to zero, it means it is the rate at which present value of inflows is equal to present value of outflows, or I can say it is a rate which is actually earned on a project. I will be dealing with two case studies. One case study A, I have taken 3 cash flows because I want to explain something other than that. So I have not taken a longer cash flows. I have taken 3 years. Let the cash flow be, in the first year be $700, second year be $600, and in third year be $300. And in the first year, the outflow is $1,000. Now the point is, outflow is in the zero period, that is minus. Then cash inflow is in the first year, cash inflow is in the second year, cash inflow is in the third year. It means I can say this type of cash flow structure is conventional cash flow structure. What I mean by conventional? Actually, the questions which I did in lecture number one or in lecture number two, all are conventional. Now, what I mean by conventional? It means if the sign changes only once. Now, what is the meaning of a sign? You know, cash outflows we relate with minus sign, and all cash inflows we relate with positive sign. And when the sign only changes one time, you know, only once, for example, if I say this is a negative sign, this is positive, this is positive, this is positive. So these types of inflows are named as conventional. But if the sign changes more than one time, for example, here minus, then plus, then minus, then plus, it means if the sign changes more than one time, it is named as unconventional. So I will be dealing with that. Conventional or unconventional, don't worry that what is conventional or unconventional, just focus on this case study. In this case study, I have taken a cash outflow of $1,000, which will be in the zero period, and there are 3 cash inflows, which will be in the first year, second year, and third year. In the first year, cash inflow is $700. In the second year, cash inflow is $600. In the third year, cash inflow is $300. Now, if I want to calculate IRR from this information, so I can use cash flow function, because I have told you how to use a cash flow function. So press cash flow, then second clear work. So all old information has been erased. Now I am ready to start with the IRR, how to calculate it. Then CFO 0 is there, 1000 plus minus, enter frequency 1, cash inflow 1, 700. Enter downward arrow, frequency is 1, enter Second is $600, enter downward arrow frequency 1, enter. Third is $300, enter this frequency 1, compute IRR. So I will be computing IRR, and that is coming to as 32.41. I have written the steps even. Just firstly write down the mathematical equation which I will be getting, because 1000 is the cash outflow. That is in the zero period. Now this present value of outflow should be equal to present value of inflows. And inflows are in 3 years. That is in first year, in second year, in third year. First year I am getting 700, so it will be discounted at the rate of, you know, one year, because I want to calculate for present value. Then 600 will be discounted for second year discounting rate, and then 300 will be discounted at the third year discounting rate. And then, you know, I can also calculate IRR with the help of this cash flow function. Cash flow, second, clear work, 1000 plus minus, I have just told you and I have done it in front of you only. Enter downward arrow 700, enter frequencies 1, enter downward arrow 600, cash flow 2, again frequencies 1, enter 1, enter 300, enter, and then, you know, I can calculate IRR, and that is coming to as 32.41%. Now, what is the meaning of 32.41? We have already seen that it is that rate when we put it, and then NPV will become zero, or I can say it is the rate at which present value of cash inflows are equal to present value of cash outflows. So inflows are equal to outflows. Now, how I can also cross check that whether if I put interest rate as 32.41 with a cash flow function, whether NPV is zero or not. Yes, it is zero. Now, please write on this. Cross checking, in case you want to cross check, you know, that whether it is okay or not. So I can, you know, all the figures are already fitted in that. So I can directly start with compute NPV. And when I say compute NPV, the calculator will tell me, please tell me how much is the interest rate. So 32.41, enter, and then compute NPV, that is coming as 0.1130. You see, it means it is near to zero only. So I have written the steps, compute IRR, I 32.41, compute this, then that is coming as 0.1130. It means, what I want to say, up to this point we have discussed the three interpretations. The first interpretation is IRR is the rate at which NPV is zero. The second interpretation is IRR is the rate where present value of cash inflows is equal to present value of cash outflows. The third interpretation is it is a real, you know, internal rate of return without subtracting any external cost. That is named as internal rate of return. Now, case study number B, because I want to explain you one or two more points, you know, and if I tell you those points theoretically, then I think you will not be appreciating that concept. So for understanding the same, I have again taken a case study number B. Let us see what this case study B is saying to us. Calculate IRR on the basis of trial and error method. Now, in examination, they will not ask you to calculate on the basis of trial and error, but because I want that you should appreciate the logics, you should appreciate the intention, you should appreciate the process. You know, even calculator is taking some seconds. You have seen that when you press compute IRR, this calculator takes some time, some moment to give you the answer, because this calculator is also doing trial and error method. So how manually we will be doing trial and error method, just see. So in this case study, I want to tell you how we can manually calculate IRR with the help of trial and error method. So again, I have taken example, the life is 3 years, outflow is $1,000 in the zero period, 500 is positive cash inflow in first year, 500 is cash inflow in second year, 500 is cash inflow in third year. So as per trial and error method, I don't know, I want to calculate cash IRR. So I can either calculate with cash flow function, but because I want to tell you the logic, so in reality, what is the process that I want to tell you? So I am not aware that what that rate is. So in that case, I have to assume a rate. Let the rate be 10%, let the rate be 11%, let the rate be any percent, whatever you can think, you know. So let us start with 10%. So in case I assume discounting rate as 10%, in case I assume discounting rate as 10%, then how much is the NPV? That, you know, I have done it for you. NPV on 10% is $243. That you can cross-check it, because we don't want to waste time in that how that NPV, which I have already told you in lecture number 1 and lecture number 2, then how that NPV can be calculated, okay? So in order to make it 0, now the point is the NPV is positive 243. Now how to take another discounting rate, because I want to convert that NPV to 0. So it means I have to increase my discounting rate from 10% to more than 10%. Then only, you know, whenever I increase the discounting rate, my NPV will come down, you know, because NPV is calculated with the help of a discounting rate. And when discounting rate is in denominator, when it is in denominator, when I increase the denominator, then only there is a possibility that NPV will decrease. So another rate I have to assume with the help of a trial and error method. So first rate is 10% and that is 243. Now, because I want to cover this distance of 243, so I will be taking another rate, let it be 15, let it be 18, any rate whichever is coming in your mind. So I have assumed it as 15%. So if I take 15% as a rate, then with the help of, you know, cash flow function, NPV is 141. Again, it is not equal to 0 because I want to maximize it. So again, I have to take a higher rate, more than 15%. So in order to make NPV as 0, take another discounting rate and let the discounting rate be 23%. I have taken at 23%. Let the rate be 23%. I am not aware whether that 23, whether NPV is coming as 0 or not. I have to again calculate the NPV. Now NPV is $5. It means it is near to 0. So let the another rate be, 26%. Now if you calculate NPV on the basis of 26%, my NPV is coming to be $38 minus. It means now the figure is negative. But I want the zero figure. It means my IRR is must be between 23% and in between 26%. It means my IRR will fall from 23 to 26. So I can use, you know, interpolation. That if on 23% this is the NPV and on 26% this is the NPV, if the difference between 23 and 26 is of 3%, then how much will be the difference in NPV? We can calculate that way also. That is named as interpolation. But I am not telling you how to use interpolation. Firstly, being the concepts. I want to clear your concept that if the rate which are less than IRR, in that case, NPV is positive, and if I take the rates, discounting rates more than IRR, the rates in that case, NPV is negative, and the IRR is in between those two rates. So, if I take 31%, then NPV is 104. So, I have prepared a timeline for you. Firstly, I have taken 10%, then NPV is $243. Then I have taken 15%, then NPV is $141. Then I have taken 23%, then NPV is $5 positive. Then negative, negative, and negative. It means IRR must be following in between 23 and 26. So, because I want to, you know, make $5 positive as zero, so I think a very minute difference in 23% can make NPV as zero. So, I have taken 23.37 as the rate. Let that rate be. So, at 23.37, my NPV is coming to be zero. So what I want to tell you with the help of this case study, if you see all the discounting rates which are on the left hand side of IRR, that is which are on the in the lower side of IRR, that is all discounting rates which are less than IRR, in that case NPV is coming as positive. And all the rates which are on the higher side of IRR, that is more than IRR, in that case, NPV is negative. Now, if I just see NPV, you know, if positive NPV is there, I can say that accept the proposal. And if NPV is negative, I can say that reject the proposal. So on the basis of IRR, just on the basis of IRR, I cannot decide that whether this project is to be accepted or not. So I have to compare IRR with cost of capital. It means what is the real cost of capital? What is the external cost which I have to pay? Now, if IRR is more than, as in this case, 23.37 is more than 10%, more than 15%, more than 23%. So if my cost of capital is less than 23.37, I can select this also. Accept the proposal because NPV will be coming as positive. And if the cost of capital is more than IRR, then reject the proposal because NPV will be coming as negative. So this, like this, I have told you that we can interpret IRR. No doubt this trial and error method will not be testable in the examination because you can use financial calculator and you can calculate IRR. But my wish was that I should tell you the logic or I should tell you the process so that other things will be better, more clear as we move forward. So next, last point in this interpretation is a project can be accepted if IRR, that is 23.37 in this question is more than 10%, is more than 15%, is more than 23%. Now, the next part, because if you do interpretations as limitation, then only you can, you know, appreciate the next lecture number 4. That is the decision rule between NPV and IRR, that which is the best tool on the basis of which we can decide. Let me tell you earlier only that NPV is the best tool. Now, why NPV is the best tool? Because IRR has some limitations. So let me discuss those limitations with the help of a case study, because it is also very, very testable that what are the limitations of internal rate of return. So please, my dear friends, write down third point of today's lecture, limitations of IRR. Limitations of IRR. When I say limitation number one, I will say IRR assumes that, you know, in case of internal rate of return, we assume a very hypothetical assumption which is not true in the real life. It cannot be possible in real life. So, due to that assumption, you know, the results which are with the help of IRR, they are sometimes positive and they are sometimes not negative. So, we should not rely on the results as per IRR. So, limitation number one, IRR assumes that cash flows are reinvested at IRR. So first assumption is we assume that cash flows are reinvested at IRR. In real life scenario, cash flows cannot be reinvested at IRR. In reality, for example, in the last example, we have seen that IRR is 23.37. Just see in there, we have seen in this example that IRR is okay. IRR is 32.41. So we are assuming that this 700 will be reinvested at 32.41%. This 600 will be reinvested at 32.41%. This 300 will be reinvested at 32.41%. It means all cash flows can be reinvested at 32.41. This is the wrong assumption which IRR makes. So this, due to this hypothetical assumption, this IRR is not to be preferred at the time of decision making. So please write down limitation number one. IRR assumes that cash flows are reinvested at IRR itself. In real life scenario, cash flows cannot be reinvested at IRR. So for that, again, I have taken one example. Let the rate be, let cash inflows be 500, and let the cash outflow be $1,000. Now, with the help of a cash flow function, we can easily calculate how much is IRR. And I have taken that, I have concluded that, I have calculated that, and that is coming as 23.37%. Please write on this example, my dear friend, because you will be able to do all practical problems yourself if you are more serious in these case studies. Very important case studies, because lots of concepts are hidden in these case studies, which I want to tell you or explain you with the help of case studies only. I don't want to just say that please write on this limitation. Why that limitation? What is the logic behind that? What is the intention behind that? What is intuitive in that? So please write down, cash outflow is 1000, conventional cash flows, $500 is the cash inflow for first year, second year, third year. Now, if we calculate it, the IRR, then IRR is coming as 23.37, and we can use a cash flow function in real life. In examination, we will be using cash flow function with the help of which we can calculate IRR. We will not be using trial and error method. Now, in this method, this 500 which we have realized in first year, we are assuming that it can be reinvested for two more years, and we can get 23.37% as a rate of return. And the cash flow which we are realizing in second year, we can reinvest for one more year, that is okay. But the rate which we can get is 23.37. And the cash flow which we are getting on 500, there is no need to reinvest because three project is of 3 years. And if we calculate the future value, that is coming as 1877. For example, 761 is the future value of first year cash inflow, that is $500 which we have received at the end of first year, which is reinvested for 2 years, and the interest rate is 23.71%. You can calculate with the help of a time value of money that how much is the future value. If present value is this, then how much is the future value? Similarly, for second year's cash inflow, if present value is 500, then how much is the future value? If third year also we can calculate, and total amount is 1877. So like this, you know, we can calculate it. But point is, whether in real life we can get 23.37? No, this is not in real life. In real life scenario, actually it is less than that. So let that rate be 10%. So please hide on this. Suppose in real life scenario, cash inflows can be reinvested at 10%, because we have to talk of reality. Now, that the cash inflow which we have realized in the first year, that is $500, can be reinvested for 2 years, but the rate we are getting is 10%. Similarly, the cash inflow of second year, that is $500, can be reinvested for one more year, and the rate is 10%. So the point is, in reality, the actual rate which we get on reinvestment is not IRR. That is a hypothetical figure. So it can be less than that. In that case, what will be the future value? That future value will be less than the figure which we have calculated on the basis of 23.37. So this type of, you know, let the rate be 10%, then it is 1655, and if we see here, it is 1877. The future value which we will be getting by assuming that the cash inflows can be reinvested at IRR is 1877, and the future value which we can assume that we can realize after, you know, reinvesting at 10% is 1655. So this is, I will say, more closer to reality as compared to the reinvestment rate of IRR. Now the point is, if I am aware of two things, you know, even with the help of TVM row, I can calculate IY, because I have told you that when I am aware of present value, when I am aware of future value, when I am aware of N, then I can calculate IY. So I have used TVM row just for understanding purpose, that if 1000 is a present value, if $1,655 is the future value, if 1 is the N, then how much will be IY? And that IY is coming as 18.28%. Hold it. Write down first. Please write it down. I'm telling you, please write it down. I will repeat it again and again. First limitation is that we are assuming that the rate of return which we can realize from those investments which are reinvested can be 23.37, that is IRR rate itself, which is not the case. In reality, it is less than that. So that 10%, if we assume that 10%, and then we calculate IRR on the basis of that, that IRR will not be named as just IRR. It will be named as modified IRR, because we have modified that assumption. So 18.28% will be named as modified IRR, and the process of TVM, you know, when we are given with present value and future value, the steps I have written for you, that how we can calculate IY, please, you can see by just making the pause to the video. I am going to limitation number two. That, you know, in case of unconventional cash flows. Now here comes the meaning of conventional and unconventional. Now even, you know, if you see Google Baba, then also I can find out that what are the disadvantages of internal rate of return. The internal rate of return is used to measure and compare profitability of this IRR is a common measure. These are the advantages. These are the disadvantages. The disadvantage of internal audit is that method does not consider important factors like this, future cost or the size of the project. We will be coming to that. Even Google Baba says the same thing which we are discussing. So the second limitation is no IRR. Sometimes in a project, we cannot calculate the IRR. Now, what are those projects? Generally, those projects are having unconventional cash flows, or sometimes we calculate multiple IRRs. So when we calculate multiple IRRs, then also I will say those cash flows, those that is a limitation of IRR, that in a project we cannot calculate IRR, or there are so many different types of IRRs. Now, on which basis we can decide? Now the point is, when it will be a case, which type of cash flows will have either no IRR or will have modified IRRs. Now, there are two types of cash flows. One is conventional. Up to this time, which we have discussed, is conventional. Outflow is in the beginning and then plus, 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 plus. It means sign has changed only one time. But if sign is changing two, three times more than one, then it is named as unconventional cash flows. So please write down, in case of unconventional cash flows, we can have a scenario which will give me either no IRR or which will give me multiple IRRs. Now, which are unconventional? I have written that. Conventional is minus plus 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 plus. Conventional minus plus plus plus, the questions which we did up to this point, or the case studies which I have discussed, that is outflow in the beginning, then inflow, 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 only sign is changing one time. But if sign is changing more than once, then they are named as unconventional. When sign of cash flow changes more than once, minus, plus, plus, minus, minus, plus, plus, minus, that is unconventional. And in case of unconventional, there may be a possibility that we cannot calculate IRR, or we can calculate more than one IRR. So this is the second limitation. So we are moving to third limitation. You know, by just calculating IRR of a project, 23.37 or 32.4 in the first case study, then 23.37 in the second case study, we cannot judge, we cannot decide just on the basis of IRR. We have to take the help of a cost of capital. But in case of NPV, if NPV is positive, then we can decide that this project is to be accepted without taking the help of any other project, any other tool. But in case of IRR, we cannot decide unless or until I am aware that how much is the cost of capital. You know, if because I know that if IRR is more than cost of capital, then only it is better to accept the proposal, because IRR is a rate of return. But if IRR is less than cost of capital, then it is better not to accept the proposal. So just by calculating IRR, I cannot decide anything. So this is limitation number three. My dear friends, I know that you are writing down. Please write down. This is my humble request to you. Don't just see the video. Please write down the notes. Please prepare your class notes, because this will be helping you in the main examination. So limitation number three, IRR needs to be compared with cost of capital to come at a decision. So if a project has an NPV of positive, we can decide standalone on the basis of NPV. But in case of IRR, we cannot decide on standalone. So in case our project has IRR of 30%, we cannot decide that how much it will be having. So my dear friends, in today's lecture number three, no doubt I have not told you the decision rule, that which is decision rule is there in case of NPV is better or IRR is better. That I will be telling you in lecture number 4. But in today's lecture, the main focus points are that what are the interpretations of IRR, and what are the assumptions, and because of those assumptions, what are the limitations of IRR, and what is conventional cash flow, what is unconventional cash flow, when there is a possibility of having no IRR or multiple IRRs, in which type of cash flow, and what is the meaning of modified IRR. Hope you have enjoyed the lecture. Please attend lecture number 4, because in lecture number 4, I will be covering learning outcome number B in totality. I will be telling you what are the different types of projects are there. What is mutually exclusive? What is independent project? Which type of tool is better? So that is very worth watching that video. Be happy, be jolly, be cheerful.